I've come back to Bristol to trace where my compulsion started to take hold.
I was at Bristol University and I left after a year and a half, and that's when I started controlling my world a lot more. And that's also the time I moved in with three other comics, Mark, John and Russell. And my memory of living with them is very... I remember being very angry a lot of the time about a lot of stuff that didn't matter, and that's the first time I really realised it was going to cause problems with other people and with friends. I spent a lot of time moaning about teaspoons, which I sorely regret now.
I'm here to meet up with my old flatmates. Comedians John Robbins, Mark Holder, and an up-and-coming young scamp named Russell Howard, who you may have seen on one of the other channels.
We did have arguments about the teaspoons because they would disappear.
The spoon wars.
What we call the spoon wars.
The spoon wars of 2006.
Of all the people I've met who I would say are on a scale, I would say you're probably the furthest left in that you have no compulsions or bacteria things at all.
If I left some Rice Krispies hanging around, I don't give a shit. Whereas you would put as much into everything, into every tiny little thing, which is probably overall better, but it just must be exhausting to kind of spend all that effort writing comedy and then go, right, now I've got to sort my shoes out. And but that same level of dedication to menial tasks.
That did unhinge you quite a lot, is when it's the lack of control.
I feel like I could have saved you if it weren't for him. I feel like...
For me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because every time I just got you around to washing the cups properly and things, you would just sort of pour chocolate into the radiator. And then you would just think, I'm not going to worry about the cup anymore. You know, in terms of the wider perception of obsessive compulsive disorder, it's something that, whether you thought I had a genuine case or not, you were quite happy to play with. People would take spoons into their rooms. When you take them into your room, you're stealing them. You're not just leaving a spoon and not washing it.
But hang on, you didn't mind that. It didn't kill you.
It didn't kill me, but it made me tense in my house. But I used to go and sleep in the car some nights because I hated being in the house because I thought, oh, my God, they hate me and they know that I'm an arsehole about spoons.
Do you remember? Oh, that's awful.
Living with other people and thinking...
When did that happen?
Quite a few nights I would go to sleep.
They didn't.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, I would have changed their ways. If you were that miserable, I didn't know you were that upset.
It was interesting to hear them say that they wish I'd told them that I was sleeping in the car because the mess bothered me. Because that, to me, is the nub of the issue. Because my belief is that things should be done that way, I don't want to have to nag at people. I just believe it should, so it gets to me when it's not. And I put the fault on me. I'm not happy with my compulsion. I know it's my problem, so I will go out to the car because it's my fault and I deserve to be unhappy for wanting it a certain way.
Driven by misery over teaspoons and my other compulsions, I moved out and went to live alone in the most anonymous place I could think of.
I came to an area that you can see has absolutely nothing for it. And here on the left is my old flat. Ah, they've got the wrong bin out. They've got 32's bin out.
In a perfectly rectangular two-bedroom flat above a line of garages, my obsessions multiplied as I tried to cope with anxiety about my career.
All my compulsions were my own business, so I could just get on with them and not have to explain them to anyone. I thought if I'm moving on my own, it'll all be fine. And I would say it probably made it worse on bad days. I was sitting on the couch, the two cushions would move. I could feel one digging into my side and it wouldn't balance with how the other cushion was pressing in. And I would start sort of fidgeting and sort of ticking almost with sort of nervous energy to move things and sit, which I recognise now probably was not an improvement in my health. I was ready to live with other people again, or I certainly needed to be around people more. So I just, I got out.
It seems to me that the more anxious I get, the more my compulsions take over.
Hi, it's Jon Richardson. Thank you very much.
It's time to speak to an expert.
we've got to go past Big Gain No Pains Limited and Window Rights International.
I've come to the headquarters of Britain's biggest OCD charity.
Hello.
I want to know if compulsive behaviour is all there is to OCD.
This is the centre of OCD action.
Yeah.
We're a national charity, but it's two small rooms. We have lots of people calling in who feel embarrassed about going to the doctor or call us first. So they kind of come out to us, if you like, and then we sort of talk things through with them.
The bottom end of the scale, it's almost cool now, I think, for young people to say, I'm a bit OCD about my pens or my T-shirts and things like that. How easy is it to say what is a characteristic of OCD and what is something else? Would you say everyone is on the scale at some point?
The vast majority of people from this country, from humanity, would have elements of them that are OCD-like, and people will move up and down that scale all the time. I remember just one call that we took on our helpline really sticks out to me. So this is a guy phoning up saying, I think I've got OCD, it's really affecting me in my life. I'm checking, constantly checking what I'm doing. He said, OK, well, tell me a bit about yourself, what's going on? So I'm a civil engineer, OK, I build bridges, right? And I'm checking all the time that they're all right. And I'm thinking,
Good.
Good, right? But this guy is spending hours and hours and